We're coming from 1 Peter. 1 Peter, the first chapter, the third verse through the fifth verse. Amen. 1 Peter, the first chapter, the third verse through the fifth verse. If you have it, please stand for the reading of God's word. It's also on our screen as well if you do not have your Bible with you. I'm not going to read it for you long. Just want to give you a presentation because we know the story of Jesus' resurrection. 1 Peter, the first chapter, the third verse through the fifth verse, New King James Version, and it reads as follows. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Amen. You may be seated. Right now, I'll just use for a few minutes, just for a few moments, the topic, when God hits the on switch. All right. When God hits the on switch. Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you once again for being in your presence. Thank you for your love, your joy, and your peace. Thank you for allowing us to study your word one more time. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, as we open up your word, Heavenly Father, we ask that you open up our spiritual understanding that we may receive your word, place it in our hearts that we may not sin against you. So Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that if there's somebody here who does not know Jesus Christ as their Savior, that they will say, what must I do to be saved? In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen, amen. When God hits the on switch. So, on this Easter morning, let me ask you to consider a few personal questions. What do you think happens to you when you die? Do you think there's an afterlife? Do you think we continue after death? Or do you think life is like an on and off switch? And then when you die, you just click off and nothing ever happens again. Are you not sure that what happens after death? Do you think that it's impossible for anyone to know? But I want to tell you this morning that the Bible speaks clearly and authoritatively that we know what happens to you after you die. And it tells us without us even doubting, without us even kind of fear, that we know what God wants for us after we leave here. So the Bible is full of strong and specific promises in this life to tell you that if you put your trust in Jesus, he's going to take care of everything. God has given us promises in the Bible that go beyond death, that go beyond the grave, promises that when death hits the off switch, God hits the on switch. Let me say that again. When death hits the off switch, God hits the on switch. It's called the resurrection. That's why we're here. See, we're here because over 2,017 years ago, Jesus died on the cross, right? And we have to understand why he died. So this morning, we're going to look at a passage of scripture where God is talking about the on switches promises that he wants to give you through Jesus Christ. But that brings me to point number one. If you look on the screen, we have point number one, and it's this. Good Friday comes before the resurrection. Point one, Good Friday comes before the resurrection. Before we can talk about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we gotta talk about what happened on Good Friday. We gotta talk about what happened 2 days ago. Jesus died on a Friday. And we gotta understand, why did Jesus die on Friday? Why did he have to die? See, in the Old Testament it says this, in order for you to be forgiven of your sins, there must be shedding of blood, right? So somebody had to die. And Jesus not only died, he died an excruciating death. He died a shameful death. Did you know crucifixion is the cruelest death ever invented? And the Old Testament says that anyone who dies on the tree is cursed. So not only has Jesus become a curse for you, he died an excruciating death, and he died a shameful death. The Bible tells us that all mankind has fallen short of God's glory. Is that right? So we are sinners separated from God. We are sinners separated from his love. We are sinners separated from his grace. As a matter of fact, there's another verse of the Bible says that it's appointed to man to die. And once he dies, after this is the judgment. Now, the judgment that he's talking about is judgment for those who will be judged because they won't receive the blessing that God had already given them through his son, Jesus Christ. So what comes after death? Judgment is the eternal judgment that comes after death for living a life of sin without accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior. So still, the question is, why was Jesus cursed? Why did he die? Can I tell you, he died to take your place? Can I tell you, he died to be your substitute? He died because you couldn't die for yourself. He died because no matter how many years you spend in hell, you cannot pay for the sin debt that you have incurred in your life. Because, and this is the reason why, it's because you have been born in sin and shaped into iniquity. So God said, listen, I'll send my son to die for you, to die for your sins, past, present, and future, so you can have a right to the tree of life. Somebody need to say amen. Okay, so somebody will have to pay for your sins, right? Either you're going to pay for your sins or somebody else is going to pay for your sins. And I guarantee you, nobody going to pay for your own sins other than Jesus Christ himself. So if you don't want Jesus to pay the penalty for your sins, guess who got to pay for them? You do. Let me tell you how long it's going to take you to pay for your sins if you don't want Jesus to do it. So let me tell you how long it's going to take you to pay. Forever and ever in hell. So guess what? Isn't God good that he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for your sins? That brings me down to point number two, and that's this. God turns the eternal life switch on. Did you know that? God turns the light switch on. When does he turn it on? He turns it on right now. Watch this, go to verse 3. Now it brings us to the passage of scripture. Verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, watch this, according to his abundant mercy, God got mercy, has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So watch this, once you have understood what happened on Good Friday and you put your faith in Jesus Christ, can I tell you what happens to you? God turns the eternal life switch on right then and there. He don't wait till you die to turn the light switch on. Guess what? He turns it on before you die. So right now, if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you are actually living in eternal life. Right now, if you got a relationship with Jesus Christ, you are already sealed with eternal life. Right now, if you put your faith in Jesus and believe that he paid for your sins at the cross over 2,000 years ago, guess what? You have eternal life right now. Yeah, no. I said, listen, right now, not when you die, you got it now. That's why you need to tell your family and friends they need Jesus now. You need to tell everybody you can they need Jesus right now. Because God, when you believe in him, he turned the switch on. So guess what? You ain't got to wait wait till you die to get eternal life. He gave it to you now. So what does that mean? That means this, that it means that we have hope that when we die, eternal life will be ours. Now, let me tell you what that word hope means. A lot of us think that hope means it's something that we hope will happen but may not happen. But the Greek word for the word hope doesn't mean that. The Greek word for hope means this. It means something that is certain to happen, but not yet. So when we say we hope when we die that we go to heaven, we're not saying we hope that we make it in or not. No, that's not what we're saying. We're saying that we are on our way to heaven. We're just not going yet because we're still alive. Eternal life is yours now while you are alive. Eternal life belongs to you. So guess what? If eternal life belongs to you now, then what are you supposed to be doing with that eternal life? You're supposed to be living for him. You're supposed to be speaking for him. Because he gave you eternal life now. He didn't wait till you died to give it to you. He gave it to you while you're alive. So now you need to tell the world, listen, I live for him because I have eternal life. They say, well, how do you know you got eternal life? You're not dead. How do you know? Because it says in the word right here that God has given to me eternal life because, watch this, his son rose from the dead on the third day. Notice what it says in verse 3. Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you have hope that he's going to what? Raise you up when he comes back to receive his church. So, through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God turns the eternal life switch on. Let me show you something about Jesus and his resurrection. Did you know that Jesus is the only one who has died and rose from the dead and never died again? Let me say that again. Jesus is the only one who has died and rose from the dead and never died again. So let's go back to, wait a minute. A lot of people rose from the dead, yes. Remember just maybe a couple of weeks before Jesus died, he rose Lazarus from the dead. But Lazarus is dead today, isn't he?
Yes.
He's dead, he died again. Well, what about all those people? Remember Jesus died on the cross and the scripture says there was an earthquake and people got out of the grave on the day Jesus died on the cross. Yes, the dead. Even on that day, but every last one of them died again. Well, preacher, I got you. Well, let's go back to the Old Testament. What about Enoch? Enoch didn't even see death. But that's my point. He didn't die. He was taken up before he died. What about Elijah? Once again, he never died. Elijah was taken up in the whirlwind before he died. So once again, Jesus is the only one who died, watch this, and rose from the dead, never to die again. As a matter of fact, can we say he's the first one? So guess what? If he's the first one, guess what? There's going to be so many more that comes after him that when we die, watch this, we will never ever die again. Watch this. When the rapture takes place, all that is that God, Jesus Christ, is coming back and the dead in Christ say what? Rise first. And then when they rise, they will never ever die again. You who are alive will be caught up, changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, and you will never ever die again. But you better thank God for Jesus Christ. He's the first one. He's the only one right now that is in his glorified body. Nobody is in their glorified body but Jesus until he comes back. And we need to tell him, thank you, Jesus, for doing that for us. So yes, he turned the eternal life switch on when you what? Are alive now. Which brings me down to point number three. Only got 4 points. Was there on point number three already? Watch this. Point number three. God turns the eternal life switch on forever. See, he turns it on now, but how long does he turn it on? Forever. Look at verse 4. Watch this. Verse 4. It tells you, it says, to an inheritance. Jesus Christ died to an inheritance, incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not what? Fade away. Reserved in heaven for you. Wait a minute. You mean to tell me that I have an inheritance? So when you accepted Jesus as your Savior because of what he did for you at the cross over 2,000 years ago, he gave you an inheritance. Now you might say, well, what is that inheritance? It's his inheritance. Jesus, when he died and rose on the third day, he inherited everything that his Father gave him. So what did his Father give him? Everything. He gave him the entire universe. He gave him everything that he ever created. Jesus is in control of everything. Now, there's verses in the Bible that says his inheritance is your inheritance. So whatever Jesus has, you have. So why is it that Christians walk around and they ain't got nothing? Why Christians walking around with so depressed like God is not on their side? If you hold on to your inheritance, if you call on to God who turned the light switch on to you, you'll know, God, I need your resources. I need your help. I need you in this hour. I need you in this time because I know you have given me eternal life, but now I'm calling on you to help me. So God does this. He turns on the light switch, and guess what? He leaves it on forever. So that means this. When you die, here comes death. Death wants to turn the light switch of your physical life off. And he does do it. He turns it off. But guess what God does? God comes around. Wait a minute. He accepted me as his Savior. He turns the eternal light switch back on. So when you die physically, that's not the end of you because you have eternal life now. Death may only can shut down your body, but it can't shut down your spirit. Right? Death may only shut down your brain, but it can't shut down the spirit man on the inside. So when death comes and turns the switch off, and you think it's done, and you think you're over here, God said, nope, you're not done. He flipped the switch back on. Isn't God good? Why does he do it? He does it because you got eternal life now. You see, because you invested in Jesus Christ now, that investment lasts all the way even after you die. I'll give you a perfect example. You say, I don't understand that. Yes, I think you do. You know, the state and the government tells us that when we drive, we're supposed to have insurance. Right? Why do we have insurance on our cars? Because just in case you have an accident. Right, you can pay, maybe your car can be paid for to get the fix of the tore-up car that you have, right? But since you ride dirty, you know, since you don't want no insurance, you try to talk the guy or the girl out. Listen, I ain't got no insurance, so listen, give me your number. I'll take you, get my number, I'll pay the money for your car to get fixed. You never hear from them again, you know that, right? You don't even hear from them. But if you had your insurance, you wouldn't even have to worry about it. Now some of you might say, well, see, look, I've been paying, and I know you have, I have too. We've been paying our car insurance for years, and I've never been in a major car accident. And so I think back in my mind, man, all that money that I gave to the insurance company, and I've never been, but guess what? I may need it one day. Just because I didn't need it then, don't mean I will never need it. So guess what? When you accepted Jesus as your Savior, you just got spiritual life insurance. Did you know that? You got it right now. You might not need it right now. You may not need it tomorrow. But one of these days, you're going to cash that insurance policy in. You're going to say, God, yes, keep the light switch on. So death is that ultimate elephant in the room. We know this. We know that one day we will die. But we don't talk about it because we don't want to think about it. Funerals confront us with the reality that death, but unless it's somebody else, unless it's somebody very close to us, we let it go by. Unless the person who died that we know of, we really don't think about it. We only think about it if it's your family member. We only think about it if it's your close friend. But guess what? People are dying every day. And they have to make a decision whether they need to accept Jesus Christ or not. But guess what? Death wasn't in God's original plan for us. It was not. When Adam and Eve was created, God didn't originally want them to die. Remember what God said to them? The day that you eat of this fruit, you shall surely die. And some of you may say, well, they didn't die that day. I think Adam was 500 and something years old when he died. Well, he died that day. He died what? Spiritually. So guess what? Death did take place when Adam and Eve sinned against God. So guess what? That death that was connected to Adam and Eve was passed down to their children. So you have no excuses to say that you don't have any sin because you were born in it, right? You were raised in it. There's nothing that you can do about it. So God said this, I'll come give my son to get rid of the sin in your life if you accept my son, Jesus Christ. Now that's real simple, isn't it? I don't know why people want to make Christianity hard. I don't know why people want to make salvation hard. It's accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, live for Him, and you will have eternal life. It is as simple as that. Oh, but here's the problem. We don't want to give up what the world is doing. We don't want to give up what death is connected to. So we thought that when we get saved and when we accept Jesus, that this is going to happen. I can still do what I want to do and still call myself a Christian. But it don't work that way. You see, when God sent His Son and gave Him for you and you said, I accept Him, you got to live the way He wants you to live, not the way you want to live. You know, the Bible calls death, it calls it our last enemy. So death is an enemy, right? Death is our enemy. It was an enemy to Jesus Christ. It was an enemy to all those saints before, and it is an enemy to us today. But we're here today to believe and thank God that Jesus defeated death. He defeated death by rising from the grave, watch this, over 2,017 years ago. Death loves to turn the off switch on in your life. Did you know that? He loves to come in your life. Has death ever come to you and turned the off switch of your finances off? You know he done that. Has the death ever come into your life and turned the off switch of your relationships with your children and with your family member off? Has death ever come in? You know what the word death means. It means separation. Has death come and separated you from the love of God? Has death come and separated you from living for Jesus Christ? When death comes and turns any type of switch off in your life, remember, you got eternal life now. God will turn it right back on. You gotta say, listen, thank God that I know I'm going through this trial. I know I'm going through this tribulation. And death, you have turned certain things off in my life, but guess what? God flipped the switch back on and says, I got life now. I got life more abundantly. So when one job closed the door, God's gonna open up another door for your job. You may have a lot of bills in your family, but guess what? Guess what? God's still gonna take care of you. You gotta just pay one bill at a time, right? You may even get a diagnosis from the doctor. Guess what? That whatever the doctor said, that's not the end of you. Because you got what? Eternal life. We all gotta leave here. Can I tell you, you're not gonna live to be 120? Can I tell you that? So if you think you're going to live here in your physical body the way you are, I think you need to get a grip on reality. We all leaving here. Do you know anybody 150 years old? No, I don't think you. Do you know, I think Frederick Douglass is there. I think Harriet Tubman and all of them gone. But they lived to be old. They was in their 90s and their 80s when they lived. None of them are here with us today. Anybody in the 18th century still living? No. Anybody in the 19th century still here? I don't think so. So you have a time. Somebody said, when is my season? Let me tell you when your season is. You said, watch this. Your season is the day you're born and the day you die. So in between the day you were born and until the day you die was your season. You talking about this is my season to be blessed, this is my season to be. No, your season is every day to do what God called you to do. Your season is to be blessed every day you are alive. Your season today is to give God praise and glory. Don't wait till you get a little money in your pocket to say, it's my season. Don't wait till you get a new suit to say, it's my season. Don't wait until you get a new house to say, God bless me. He blessed you when He woke you up this morning. When He put you in your right mind, He blessed you so you can give Him the praise for everything that you have right now. Isn't God good? Yes, He is. That brings me down to my last point, to point number four, and that's this. When you look on the screen there, for God's power switch will guard our lives while we wait on Him in heaven. Did you hear that? God's power switch will turn the God power switch will guard you. Listen to verse 5. It says this: who are kept by the power of God through death for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last day. So we already talked about in verse 3. That God turns the power switch on now. In verse 4, God turns the eternal life switch on forever in verse 4. So now that's after you die. But now you got to say, but what happens between now and then? What happens between while I'm living and before I die? I know I got eternal life. Heaven is my home when I die. Yeah. But what do I got to do now? It says here in verse 5, God going to keep you. He's going to keep you through all your trials and tribulations. He's going to keep you through your problems. What do you mean? He's going to keep you. Watch this. Have you ever thought about this? You didn't save yourself.
Come on now.
So watch this. If God saved you, if He saved you by His grace, He saved you by His love, you didn't save yourself. You are not saved by your good works. You're not saved by how much money you give to the church. You're not saved by how many times you attended these services. That don't save you. God's not going to look at you on that day and say, Eli, yeah, you went to church 90% of the time. Come on in to the church. No, he doesn't do that because my church attendance is well. Eli, you gave 10% of your income most of the time. Come on in to heaven. He don't look at how much I gave that to determine if I'm going to make it into heaven. Guess what he looks at? He looks at my heart. Yeah. He looks at to see if I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. So he says this, between now and then, between now and me dying, I need to wait on the Lord. Between now and before you go to heaven, you need to believe that God got your back. Between now and before you go to heaven, you need to hold on to God's unchanging hand. You need to say this. You say, listen, even though I'm going through trials and tribulations, I'm going to hold on to God's unchanging hand. Why? Because God has turned on the eternal life switch in my life. Yes, I need to hold on right now to believe that God is going to make a way out of no way. God has turned and given me His inheritance. He gave me His Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for my sins. So God has turned on the eternal life switch. He said He's going to guard me. He's going to guide me. He's going to lead me to everything that He wants me to live. So that means this: no matter what life brings my way, no matter what sickness comes my way, I believe that I have eternal life right now. But it starts with the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He died so I could have a right to the tree of life. So guess what? I don't care how many switches have been turned on in your life. I don't know how many times death comes your way, trying to separate you from God, trying to separate you from His word, trying to separate you from praying. But you need to say, God, thank you for turning and hitting the light switch of eternal life in my life. What you want to know that, listen, when you read His word, He turns the light switch back on in your life. He'll wake you up through His word. He'll wake you up through your prayer life. He'll wake you up through your experience. But you got to say, listen, I live this life because Jesus died for me over 2017 years ago. Can I get a witness here? Do you believe He died to set you free? Do you believe He hit the light switch for you and for me? Don't you agree with me that Jesus saved us from our sins? We were on our way to hell, but He saved us from our sins. We were on our way to pay for our own sins. But God said, listen, I got another plan for you. If you accept my Son, guess what? I'll erase everything that's happening in your life. Somebody need to say hallelujah. Somebody need to say thank you, Jesus. He erased all of your debt. He erased all of your sins. He erased all of the things that was going through your mind. We serve a good God. He hit the light switch so you can turn your life around. for dying on the cross. Over 2,000 years ago, somebody say yes. Somebody say yes. He did all right. Had he hit the light switch in your life? Had he turned your light on in your life? Had you fought many death tackles in your life? How many of you fought many death fights in your life? Word, every knee bowed and every eye closed. Father, in the name of